have small groups and classes that continue this week. There's a potluck meal at 6 p.m. before the small groups start at 6:30. The classes that are offered, Matt Ford is doing a study on Genesis. Stanley Maroney and Tim Reed are doing a class on Dave Ramsey's Total Money Makeover. Jennifer Douthat is doing a small group called Grow. Then there's Youth and Kids Central. And one other thing, Chick-fil-A night for Christ Central Youth is September 28th, and you can see details about that on the church website, and there'll probably be more information coming between now and then. One other thing, Kat Maddox has got a little something that she needs to mention.
Today is our casserole pickup. If you've ordered casserole, we've got them all in the... we've got them all in the, food pantry room. We've got them all ready to set up, and we've got some extra. We've got some medium size and some few small sizes we made extra if you didn't order any, but we'll have them all ready for you to just pick up and pay us today. And then we'll do this again at the end of this month, and we'll bring them back on the second Sunday of the month next month. So we're going to try it again. So far it's done pretty good, so we'll see how this goes. Thank you.
Thank you, Kat. And that's all of our announcements. I'm going to turn it over to Pastor Mark.
Can I have the ushers come forward, please? Is that you too, Keith? Why did you even leave me then? As a forgiven and reconciled people, let us offer our tithes and gifts to the Lord as an act of worship. Holy Father, I do ask that you bless the giving of these tithes by the power of your Spirit in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. May it be so. Amen. Grace. It's always grace, right? Time now to pass the peace of Christ to one another.
If you would please remain standing as we sing Worship the Lord together through song. I wandered so aimlessly, a life filled with sin. I couldn't let my dear Savior in. Then Jesus came like a stranger in the night.
Praise the Lord, I saw the light. I saw the light, I saw the light. No more in darkness.
was a fool to wander and stray. Straight is the gate and narrow the way. Now I have traded the wrong for the right. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. I saw the light, I saw the light. No more in darkness, no more in night. Now I'm so happy, no sorrow in sight. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. Some glad morning when this life is o'er, sure, I'll fly away. I'll fly away, oh glory, I'll fly away. When I die, hallelujah, by and by, I'll fly away. When the shadows of this life have grown,
before you should be now. Preacher, we got them awake for you. Now it's up to you.
Okay. What a fellowship, what a joy divine meeting on the everlasting arms. What a blessedness, what a peace is mine meeting on the everlasting arms. Leaning, leaning, safe and secure from
seated.
Our scripture today is 1 Timothy 1, 12 through 17. This is Paul's words. I thank Christ Jesus our Lord, who has given me strength, that he considered me trustworthy, appointing me to his service. Even though I was once a blasphemer and a persecutor and a violent man, I was shown mercy because I acted in ignorance and unbelief. The grace of our Lord was poured out on me abundantly, along with the faith and love that are in Christ Jesus. Here is a trustworthy saying that deserves full acceptance. Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am the worst. But for that very reason, I was shown mercy, so that in me, the worst of sinners, Christ Jesus might display his immense patience as an example for those who would believe in him and receive eternal life. Now to the King, eternal, immortal, invisible, the only God, be honor and glory forever and ever. Amen.
Amen.
Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we praise you and thank you for coming into this world to save us from our sins. During this time of worship, help us to focus on you and not let ourselves be distracted. Please bless Mark as he brings the sermon today, and be with us in the coming week. Let us be a light to others. In Jesus' name, amen.
Would you stand with us as we sing together again?
I cling to the cross and everything it means. I know it's the only hope there is for saving me. For without your great mercy, I would be forever lost. With a thankful heart, I come and cling to the cross. I cling to the cross, everything it means. I know it's the only hope there is for saving me. For without your great mercy, I would be forever lost. With a thankful heart, I come and cling to the cross. Standing at the empty tomb, promises I have in you arise. I was made alive in you, everything you said was true. You suffered, died, and rose to bring us life. I cling to the cross, everything it means. I know it's the only hope there is for saving me. For without your great mercy, I would be forever lost. With a thankful heart, I come. Jesus, I come. With a thankful heart, I come. Cling to the cross. The world behind me, the cross before me. The world behind me, the cross before me. The world behind me, the cross before me. The world behind me, the cross.
the darkness we were waiting, without hope, without light, till from heaven you came running. There was mercy in your eyes to fulfill the law and prophets. To a virgin came the word, from a throne of endless glory to a cradle in the dirt. Coming and to reconcile the lost, to redeem the whole creation. You did not despise the cross, for even in your suffering you saw to the other side, knowing this was our salvation. Jesus, for our sake you died. That stone was moved for good, for the Lamb had conquered death. And the dead rose from their tombs, and the angels stood in awe, for the souls of all who'd come to the Father are restored. And the Church of Christ was born, then the Spirit lit the flame. Now this gospel truth of old shall not kneel, shall not faint. By his blood and in his name, in his freedom I am free. For the love of Jesus Christ, who has resurrected me.
Gave me 3 extra minutes to preach there, David.
Did I?
Yeah.
Oh, well.
Yeah. I like it.
No.
Are you going to play another song? Just one. Hey, guys, look up here. It looks like angels' wings on the ceiling. Feel like God is blessing us. I don't know why. I was thinking to myself just before I walked up here, I'd be forever lost if it wasn't for Jesus Christ, if it wasn't for the cross. You know, I was listening to that song. A lot of times when I'm listening to that song, you'll see me grab a piece of paper and a pen and start writing, jotting stuff down. Because God is always working on me, and he's always working on the sermon that he wants me to give too, right up until the point it comes out of my mouth, okay? So he was working on me, and I was thinking about those that are lost in the darkness of this world and how extravagant God's love was to continue to search for them and guide them. And then he told us, look, I want you to guide them to Jesus too, to guide them to the cross. And that's our job. Our task is to guide them to the cross. And sometimes it's like herding sheep. I mean, no, sometimes it's like herding cats. Yeah, sheep too. But same thing, right? I'm telling you, we want to guide people to the cross. And I was telling the shepherds this morning, the shepherds' Sunday school class, that I feel that need to guide people to the cross all the time. And I also know that not everybody's in the same part of their journey. So it might be that I'm taking the person who is drowning in a pool of sin, who's searching desperately in the darkness for Jesus Christ. It might be that I walk alongside him long enough for just one of those sins to drop away, and for that one sin to have repentance. I'm not worried about the other 99 sins yet, you know? It might be that. That might be my part of that person's journey, is to help them with that one thing. And never stop helping. And never stop helping. Lost, but not abandoned. That's what I feel like. This morning I want to talk to you about this scripture from Luke, but it's like a trilogy. It's the lost sheep, the lost coin, and the lost son. The stories are all here, and the two that we're going to talk about this morning represent two-thirds of that trilogy of parables that is completed by the prodigal son. And you guys remember that story, right? You probably remember the lost sheep, and you probably remember the lost coin too. It's something we've talked about before. It's something that some other pastors talked about before, I'm sure. Maybe hundreds of times. The first and the third parable tell us something about God, to be sure. But the middle parable, involving the woman and the lost coin, is kind of set in a real world kind of setting. Because the lost coin, it represents like a week's wage. Now, I want you to just think about losing a week's worth of pay. That could be something pretty substantial in our lives, couldn't it? It could make it so we might not be able to pay a bill. That's a real world thought. You know, a real world thought. But let's take the time to pray our way into it. Everlasting Father, wonderful counselor, you are the Almighty God. You are all-knowing and all-seeing, and you are love. We praise and adore your holy name for who you are and for the things that you do for us. God, we approach you this morning in your multitude of mercy for us. We know that you know our ways. Help us to not be wise in our own eyes. So, Lord, we ask that you lead us today and give us guidance and direction and clarity and wisdom into your truth. Lord Jesus, order our steps by your Holy Spirit. Let our choices be guided by your word and your will. Let us not go ahead of you, but wait patiently for your timing and your guidance. May this be so. In the name of Jesus Christ, I pray. Amen. Our scripture this morning is coming from Luke 15, 1 through 10. It is the parable of the lost sheep, starting off with. Now the tax collectors and sinners were all gathering around to hear Jesus. But the Pharisees and the teachers of the law muttered, "This man welcomes sinners and eats with them? Are you kidding me?" Then Jesus told this parable. "Suppose one of you has 100 sheep and loses one of them? Doesn't he leave the 99 in the open country and go after the lost sheep until he finds it? And when he finds it, he joyfully puts it on his shoulders and goes home. Then he calls his friends and neighbors together and says, "Rejoice with me, I have found my lost sheep." I tell you that in the same way, there will be rejoicing in heaven over one sinner who repents than over the 99 righteous persons who do not need to repent. Or suppose a woman has 10 silver coins and loses one. Doesn't she light a lamp, sweep the whole house, and search carefully until she finds it? And when she finds it, she calls her friends and neighbors together and says, "Rejoice with me, I found the lost coin." In the same way, I tell you, there's rejoicing in the presence of the angels of God over one sinner who repents. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. There's angels rejoicing. I don't know who it is this morning he's rejoicing over, but he's rejoicing. This parable itself, it reminds me of the blockbuster trilogies, you know, which I'm terrible. If I buy the first one, I don't care if there's seven of them. I'm getting them all. I'm watching them all because I want to see the whole story, you know. And Pam just, I drive her crazy because I'll go back and I'll watch Batman, or I'll go back and I'll watch Twilight, or I'll... But I can't just watch one. I got to watch all of them. And it takes, yeah, she gets annoyed with me over it sometimes. She's like, "Another Batman, please." I said, "But we're not done yet. The story's not told yet, you know." But in the truth of that, when those blockbusters come out, the first one, everybody loves that the best. The first one is usually the coolest one. And then if there's three of them, the second one comes out and, then the third one comes out and gives us that strong ending, right? That really strong ending. But the middle installment, that's a problematic one. The second film has to do all of the heavy lifting, okay? It has to keep the story moving. It has to deepen the plot without even actually having an ending. You know, it has to suck you into the third one so you'll come and watch that, right? Doesn't get the payoff. And when it comes to the critics, the middle part, that second movie just usually doesn't get good reviews. You know, it doesn't get any of the respect it deserves for carrying the other two sides, you know, at all. Today's scripture includes parts one and two of this blockbuster trilogy. However, it's the parable of the lost sheep and the prodigal son too. They're celebrated. Those two parables, the lost sheep and the prodigal son, there is a plethora of books in libraries and museums of studies based on those two, but not very much about the coin that got lost, because it's the middle movie and not everybody gives it that much respect. That's the one I really want to talk to you about this morning, is that middle one. This parable about the woman who just loses her mind because she's lost a coin, and she turns her whole house upside down to find it, is the most down-to-earth parable. Because if I lost a week worth of wages, I'd be tearing that house apart trying to find it. Okay? I would be doing it. And it's set in kind of the place where we live, where things can be difficult very quickly, very easily, isn't it? Where all of a sudden, 1 week's worth of wages can put some real stress in our lives, some real difficulty in it. It goes without saying that the prodigal son's father, he's a rich guy, right? I mean, he's got rings to give, calves to slaughter, you know. He gives his son the inheritance, lets him go off, but still has enough to keep things going, you know, and still have enough for his older son to have an inheritance too, right? He employs many people, right? Even after all of this, he has this large estate that he's managing. Likewise, the man who goes out looking for the lost sheep, he's not just a shepherd, by the way. He left the shepherd with the sheep, no doubt. That's somebody he paid to do that job, right? But he goes out to look for the lost sheep. So, hey, any shepherd during that time who owns 100 sheep, this guy's got some funds. He's doing okay for himself, okay? Now, anyone who raises an animal knows that loss is inevitable. In addition to the predators and things like that, there's disease and sheep. Sheep just wander off sometimes. They just wander off. That's the way sheep are. Indeed, in some cultures, when a sheep wanders off, when they find it, they destroy it. Because they don't want that sheep to wander off and take 10 other sheep with it the next time. So the wanderer kind of gets made for dinner. Yeah, that's right. And really, when you think about it, who would just walk off and leave their whole flock going to look for one sheep? Not very many shepherds would do that, you know. Besides, if the owner of the flock had held that celebration afterwards, guess what it would have been for dinner? The sheep. That's what it would have been for dinner at the celebration. He'd be expected to slaughter something. Very likely it would be that one that wandered off so that. And the same with the prodigal son. They, what, slaughtered a calf, right? When they, that was a great celebration. What makes the lost sheep a great parable is not that it's realistic. That's not what makes it a great parable. And the word parable should tell you something to begin with. That it's a story being told to bring you to some conclusion, to give you some deeper piece of information, right? That's what a parable is. Doesn't have to be realistic to do that. But what it does do, especially this one about the lost sheep, is it displays how wonderfully extraordinary God's unconditional love is. How far God would go for you. How far God would go for me. That's the depth of the parable. That God loves us this much. God is depicted as a shepherd in several of the Psalms, and God's people are depicted as the sheep in the scriptures. And there's always rejoicing in heaven. That means rejoicing, that means there is a cosmic celebration. Somebody's up there going, hoo-dee-hoo for Jesus. You know, there's going to be a celebration. And it's going to be a big deal. So big that all of heaven will celebrate. Which brings me to that second parable and back to the real world. You know, the one where we have to make money and pay bills and, you know, do all the things that come along with living life, right? In contrast to the sheep who can wander off, coins are different. They don't just wander off. They don't just all of a sudden decide they're going to get up and go astray, right? They may be misplaced. They may be stolen, thrown out with the trash accidentally, or spent and not remembering what you spent it. That could all happen. But they don't deliberately wander away from, you know, our pocket or our purse. Something had to happen for that to go away. You know, what it reminds me of is people or sheep. Wandering away is a people thing. It's a sheep thing. When we get into those difficult times in our lives and we're wondering where God is, in our lives, it isn't because he left. It isn't because he's not involved. It always has to do with me. Because God doesn't wander away. He doesn't forget about us. That's not who God is. And could God actually lose us? I mean, really? Well, of course not. He's counted the hairs on our heads. He knows what we're doing. Knows where we are. He's standing right there beside us going, hey, standing right here. Standing right here. Right? In addition, this second parable is set in a world of women during a time of men. But there's something interesting about it. When we speak about history, a lot of times when we're speaking about history, we find in our history books that it's always in the perspective of men. But because we recognize it now and we're so much further down the road than we used to be, we realize if we really want to know something about a culture, we have to study every aspect of the culture. That means we got to dig through their trash. We got to look at their teeth, see if they had fillings. We got to look at their nutritional value, what they were eating, things like that. And we have to look at men, women, children, the dogs, the sheep. We have to look at it all to get a good conclusion of what that culture was like and what that society was like. That's how we find the answers that we find. And that's how we found new answers over time, because we broadened our perspective of how we looked at things, right? And that kind of study takes a lot to accomplish. For instance, they did some recent excavations in Pompeii. And what they found out were the dwellings that they lived in were so small that they didn't have any place to eat or prepare a meal in the dwelling. You thought McDonald's was the first fast food place, didn't you? Come to find out, Pompeii was where fast food began. They would go to one of the shops, get something to eat it, and go back home. Fast food. So Pompeii beat McDonald's out. Of course, I don't know what they were selling, the first million shish kebabs, you know? I'm not quite sure, right? There's a consensus among Egyptologists that the Great Pyramids, we originally believed were built by slaves, that they weren't built by slaves at all. What they believe is that they were some real artisans that had respect for the leaders and great work ethic that came together and built the pyramids. Here's the interesting part. Did you know they had three different health plans they could choose from? They had health plans. The people who build the pyramids. Man, we can't get a decent health plan in America today for nothing. This middle parable also takes us into a real world in another way, where we see this woman that they are at the heart of the economy of the time. They're the ones that have the funds that are taking care of the family. That meant they were, to some extent, financially independent. She would generally handle all the things that were unexpected that came up, the problems that sprung into a normal household. Oh, we got to fix the roof, you know. We had to get some more straw for the floor, whatever it might be, right? And it's quite likely she has other assets too. She's you know, buried a few coins back. She might have even invested in a friend's business. She might have even taken that money, invested in her own business, started sewing clothes to create more money so that the family could be better sustained. It was very, very common in this region during this time for women to do that. While the men were off drinking wine and reading scripture, I guess. Yeah. That's what it looks like sometimes. All three celebrate, though. All of the parables, there's a celebration at the end, right? In the celebration, it always calls for some kind of sacrifice. In the first and the third parts of the trilogy, an animal is sacrificed. One is is probably the lamb. The other one is a calf. And they get together and they have some food and they rejoice. This one, though, the middle one, it doesn't make any mention of any food celebration. Perhaps it involves just what it says, rejoicing. She like calls her friends over and says, guess what? I found that week's wage. Woohoo! And they're all going, well, that's a great thing. And they sit down and have a conversation. Or maybe it was a potluck. Who knows? You know? She's like, bring some food. Let's sit down and eat together. In any case, the woman calls her friends and they celebrate finding a lost week's wage. Which, first of all, is very worth celebrating, isn't it? You know, if I split mine up into weeks, boy, I would really miss a week. You know what a microloan is? Anybody ever heard of a microloan? Raise your hands in the air like you don't care. Microloan, you know what those are, right? They're a very small loan that's offered usually to people in a third world country to help them work their way out of poverty. Did you know they did a bunch of research on this? Apparently, experience has shown the lenders that men, when they get a microloan, will usually just get together, take the money, have a party, do some eating and drinking, and the money's gone. Isn't that a sad thought? Sorry, guys, just, you know, research. So normally now, they don't give microloans to men. They give them to women. Because in their experience, what the women do is they take that microloan, they buy a sewing machine or an oven or some device or product that'll help them pay off the loan. So they start cooking food for the neighborhood or making things for people, and they pay off the microloan. And then that gives them another opportunity to get another loan and pay that off, and they grow out of poverty because of it. And I kind of understand this because Pam is so much more frugal than I am. And I have learned, and most of us men that have been married for a while have learned this too, that 90% of the time, she is right. And it only took me about 10 years to realize I needed to quit arguing with her about that. Because most of the time, she's right. So what's the point of the argument? I mean, I'll get 10% every now and again, right? Those of us who are wise have learned that a long time ago, right, gentlemen? Yes, it's true. And this brings me up to an interesting question. See, most people read the three parables, and in the first parable and in the third parable, we see some representation of the aspect of God. And if these parables are consistent, if the shepherd is like God and we're like the sheep, to make the point come out, or if the dad is like God and the prodigal son is like us, then there's some representation of God's interaction and love and how far he's willing to go. So if it's consistent, shouldn't the woman tell us something about God as well? Something. There's got to be something in there. Maybe even the lengths God will go to find a lost soul. He'll clean the whole house out. If he has to, he'll take all the furniture out. Right? And another question is does God lose us or forget us? Does that ever really happen? When Scripture speaks of God remembering, it's not with an implication that God has forgotten us. But what it really is talking about is that God has made us a priority. Like the Father making the Son a priority. Like the shepherd making the lost sheep a priority. Like the woman making the coin a priority. She turned all her attention toward finding it, sweeping every corner, turning her simple dwelling upside down until she found out where that coin had rolled to, until she had it in her hand. Or in our case, until he has us in his kingdom. That's how important we are. I think sometimes we do believe that God's forgotten about us. You know, I have prayed that prayer. Where are you, Lord? I realize over time that he doesn't walk away from me. It's usually me doing the turning my, yeah, I don't really want to do it your way. I'm going over here kind of thing. I know I'm not the only one. And yet perhaps it is just a matter of sometimes our prayers are not answered the way we want them to be answered or as quickly as we want them to be answered. Have you prayed and prayed and prayed and prayed and got frustrated? If you haven't, it's coming someday, I'm telling you. Because you'll be praying over a child or a grandchild, and it just doesn't seem to be happening for them. And it's tearing your soul apart because you know you want to see them in the kingdom of heaven too. See, God's timing is not our timing. And his timing is always better for us. It may be that divine wisdom has determined when the best time is for us to be found and for our prayers to be answered. And we might need to struggle a little bit before we get there. Yes, we are his children and we inherit his kingdom. But brothers and sisters, this is not on our terms. This is all on his terms. He's God. We're not. It'll be in his timing, on his terms. And this is one more reason that the parable represents the world we live in, this real world. That the framework of this section of Scripture is about how he cares for us, how much he's willing to do to save our souls. This section opens with religious authorities grumbling because Jesus was eating with the tax collectors and sinners. See, Jesus, he welcomes these people without condoning their sins. But he still welcomes them. The focus isn't on their sin. The focus is on repentance and forgiveness, which is what our focus should always be on. You've heard, love the sinner, hate the sin, right? And you've heard that we don't fight against flesh and blood, but against powers and principalities, right? You've heard these words. I'm not the first one to speak them to you. There are so many lost people in this world. And if we are here to help them find the way, then they must become a priority for us. They must become a priority for us. And that's what's divine about these three linked stories that Jesus told. There's rejoicing over the recovery of the lost. This helps us see who we are fishing for. I mean, who are we really fishing for? I'll use this example again. I've used it before. But I'm asking you to go fish in the big pond. We don't need a Baptist to convert to Methodist. We don't need a Catholic to convert to Methodism. We need to go find the actual lost soul, the one who needs to know Jesus Christ, because he's the only way out. So we can't be fishing in the Baptist little bucket. We got to go to the big pond. And we can't be fishing in the Catholic's little bucket. We got to go fish in the big pond where there are lost souls that are drowning in a pool of sin and don't know the way out. Those are the people that we're supposed to be searching for. Those are the ones we're supposed to be fishing for. They are non-believers. They are people that don't believe in Jesus Christ. They're not on a path. They're not on the path like we are. And granted, we're a bunch of sinners, you know, scrambling on this earth in fear and trembling, hoping for salvation, knowing that there's only one way, and that is Jesus Christ. And in order for these lost to be found, what we have to do is make them a priority and go looking for them. And actually go looking for them. That's right. Or when we ourselves are lost, then we have to swallow our pride and allow our brothers and sisters to find us. Right? We have to do that. I really hope you're able to glean something from that this morning. May that be so in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Let's take a moment and pray. Holy Father, here we are, your children. And yes, we know we all fall short, Lord. We all fall short of your glory. We are sinners. We are sinners, Lord. We ask for your forgiveness. We ask for your strength. We ask for your Spirit to be upon us. And for that Spirit to help us go and bring Jesus Christ to others. Because they're as lost as we are. Lord, we ask it in the only name we know, the strongest name we know, the most loving name we know, Jesus Christ. May it be so. Amen.
You stand, please. Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary, pure and holy.
Please receive this benediction, would you? You know how I feel about you. I love you, and I want God to be in every moment of your time, everywhere you are. But I don't want to just say that and not say that I want it to be an experience for you. I want you to feel him there with you, where you are. I want him to be so indwelled in you that you recognize him. That you feel his love just welling up in you. Not only just for the other people around you, but for everybody. I pray that his presence is so indwelled in you that it has to burst out of you when you're around other people. Please try to recognize when he's trying to come out. Because generally what he's done is place you in a situation with other people where he wants you to show him to them. I hope you're able to get that this morning. May it be so in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Go in peace.